like the wind, unseen but present, moving and felt, like the seasons, changing at exactly the right time, like the pull of gravity that keeps me firmly planted to the ground beneath my feet, your faithfulness, the same yesterday, today, and forever, immovable, unshakable. Your love is steadfast and you keep every one of your promises. You will never leave and you never forsake the ones you love. You finish everything you start and never have you spoken a word in vain. As undeniable as the sun, rising day in and day out without fail, and just as certain as the setting of that same sun, you are faithful.
All right, please find your seats. Psalm 97, it says, "The Lord reigns. Let the earth rejoice. Let the many coastlands be glad. Clouds and thick darkness are all around him. Righteousness and justice are the foundation of his throne." Join me in prayer. Father, we thank you for the gift of life. We thank you for the gift of your son, Jesus, that gives us life eternal. We come this morning as your people with many different things on our hearts and our minds. And we put those things aside to focus on what matters most. Which is bringing glory to you and loving on one another. May that be accomplished today in your church here in Yacolt. We profess our love for you, and we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Please join as we sing and stand as you are able.
Together we together we sing. Forgiveness. as you wait for the crown. Tell the world of the treasure you found.
All right, you guys may be seated.
It's the first Sunday of the month, and we have the privilege, the joy of coming to the Lord's table now. So if you're like me, you kind of need to switch gears mentally and just begin to reflect on what a precious gift we have through Jesus Christ. One of the key words when we read the passage about the taking the bread and taking the wine is that we are to remember. Jesus says, "Do this in remembrance of me." So I would encourage you to just even now begin to reflect on how your life has changed since Jesus came into your life. What is different for you, both today and certainly for eternity, because of what Jesus did for us on the cross? And then as we take those elements of the bread and the juice, to remember those things, to praise the Lord that we're no longer separated from God. We're no longer a people who have no hope, but our sins are forgiven, and our day-to-day is full of the presence of God, and our eternity is just more wonderful than we can even imagine, all because of Jesus. So we are to remember, we are to reflect, we are to come to this table, and perhaps you have a sin that's weighing heavily on your heart that needs to be brought before the Lord at this time too. So let's take a few minutes and reflect and remember. And while you're doing that, the elements, the bread and the juice, are on either side of the church. So go over and get those for yourself. Come back to your seat. We'll take them all together in a few minutes. for some, you actually may have to break the piece of bread that you have to share with somebody. Anybody, there's some more. If you didn't get either the bread or the juice, Tandy's got some over here. I'll be reading from the Apostle Paul's instructions in 1 Corinthians chapter 11. For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, in the night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Let's take the bread. In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying this, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Let's take the juice. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. We've just proclaimed the Lord's death. Praise the Lord. Thank the Lord for Jesus in our lives. Before you get up for fellowship, Julie has a couple announcements she wants to share with you.
So good to see Rob and Linda back after their cross-country trip to the beautiful, across our country. So, quick impromptu announcement. We are getting ready for our Christmas program. I know, Christmas is next month. Our Christmas program here at church will be on Sunday, December 19th. And of course, the children are going to be a big part of that. So I just wanted all you kids listening up, because this morning in Jam, we're going to be going over the Christmas program, giving you an idea of what it looks like, and giving you some options of how you can be involved. So the toddlers and preschoolers are going to stay in their class. We'll get to them in weeks to come. But if you are, is Jam kindergarten or first grade? Help me out, people. First grade. If you are in first through sixth grade, then come to Jam. If you don't normally go to Jam, come to Jam. If you are even older than sixth grade, middle schoolers, we've got some parts for you too. So I'm encouraging this morning, come see what we're doing. Even if you don't think you want to be involved, I will convince you otherwise. So do we dismiss now? Okay, so kiddos, if that's you, head to the chapel. I'll be there just shortly, and the rest of you can refresh coffee, greet someone, and then we'll meet back here in a few minutes.
If you are visiting today, I'm sorry. I'll just say that if you're visiting. I'll just stop with that. No, today is a much different Sunday than a normal Sunday. That makes me a little bit uncomfortable, just to be honest with you. But you will be glad to know that the first service people said it was the shortest sermon they've ever heard me preach, which doesn't make me happy, but it made them happy. So, today really is a day primarily of celebration. And I'll get into that in just a moment, what we're celebrating. But first, before we do, just some announcements, and then most importantly, we have some really key prayer things this morning that we need to cover. But as far as announcements go, first off, for those of you in growth groups, which is I think we have over 100 people in our church body that are involved in a weekly growth group, there are no questions for you this week. That is primarily because our amazing administrative guru, Carrie Blado, was in Tennessee, which meant that I had to do the bulletin and jam the copy machine up and couldn't figure it out and wanted to take a chainsaw to it. But in any case, your black and white bulletins were printed off my desktop printer, and that's what you get. So there you go. So if you're in a growth group and you're leading a growth group, you might just find an opportunity to celebrate what the Lord is doing in your group or to talk through another devotional questions, but you don't have questions this week. Also, tonight is a special night. So every month we focus on a missionary of our church, and we pray for them throughout the month. It was the Weatheralls in Papua New Guinea last month. Well, this month it's a collective group of praying for the persecuted church. And the church around the globe is under increasing persecution. And I just read an article yesterday about a church in Nigeria. There's 63 people were taken captive. This is not uncommon. And there are Christians all around the globe that are being martyred for the sake of their faith. And we focus this month on praying for them, partnering with them however we can. And tonight at 6:30, we have a night of prayer. Our missions team is putting this on. So from 6:30 to 7:30, we just invite you to come here and to pray for the persecuted church together. Our prayer family this week, we pray for someone each week, is Spike Walker. So Spike, a wonderful brother, and we'll pray for Spike. Few other things to be keeping in prayer. One, I say praises. We've been praying for Wayne Richards since he got COVID, ended up in the hospital, and then got over COVID, but got pneumonia, and then developed blood clots, very near death. And yet he came home a number of weeks ago, and the clots have been reduced. I don't know if they're totally gone, but he did go back to work mid last week, and that's just a huge answer to prayer. And just we are thankful to God for that, and continue to pray for him as he is weaning off of oxygen. But what a great thing for the Richards family and our church family. Another thing, we've been praying for Anthony Waring, who about the same time suffered a very serious heart attack. Which put him into a coma. He consequently also had some strokes, and he's been in that coma, and they've not been able to bring him out of that coma for about 6 weeks. But this past week, there's been small incremental steps that he's taken in the right direction, and he's not woken up yet, but he's been able to be put into a rehab chair, and he's showing some movement with his eyes, which he had not been showing, and so we just want to continue to pray. Thank God that he's making those improvements, but continue to pray for them. Also, we're praying for George Hazen, who had a stroke. Heard this week that the rehab is going well. Heard that he doesn't like the rehab, which is a good sign that the rehab is going well. That's the whole point of rehab, and we're thankful that Zeta has been able to get out a little bit. There's some other things with him wanting to get out on a hunting trip. We're praying for that still for him, but we want to keep George in our prayers as he improves. The Leedy family, and I know there's a lot, but this is important. We're a church family. We need to be caught up on the prayer things. The Leedy family, so Jeff Leedy, who his parents were in Oklahoma. His dad was a pastor in a church as recently as a month ago, but his mother got so ill that he moved them across the country to live with he and his wife. His mom's name is Joyce, and once they got here, the first thing that happened was both of them and Jeffrey's wife, Linda, got COVID. And Joyce has been put in the hospital, and the rest are doing really well. She was on the significant decline, but I got a message late last night that she is doing much better, but really does need our prayer. It's not so much the physical, it's the mental, because she can't have visitors, and she's really discouraged. And so just pray for the Hayes. Her name is Joyce Hayes and the Leedy family. Another one I got just in between services, it's just heartbreaking, is on Wednesday there was a car accident, again, of some of the teenagers from our town. They're part of the Apostolic Lutheran Church, and the young man, Bodine, I believe a 16-year-old, passed away in that wreck. His parents' names are Drew and Heather. There were two other boys, 15-year-old Eddie Redinger and Curtis Joma. They were in the car. They were injured, and we want to be praying for their recovery. But boy, this is just a heavy, heavy, heavy season for even that church. There's another death in a car accident just recently with some members of our church here. So hard stuff. So we want to continue to pray for them. And the last one I'll bring up is John. John, I forget John's last name, but his brother and sister-in-law, Tom and Kim Glassett. We've been praying for John as he's had pancreatic cancer. He came through that, but he's had another relapse, and the doctors have pretty much told him that there's nothing that they can do. So they're sending him home, and we just need to pray that, one, that he would be miraculously healed, but also that the Lord would be with the families. So please join me as we pray for these many things. Father, we do trust in your gracious, sovereign hand, and Lord, we know that you know all things, and even the things in which bring us concern and grief, we know for your heart, you love perfectly, which means you love far greater than us, which means it breaks your heart more than ours. And yet we also trust that you know all things and that you can do all things. And so where your miraculous healing hand can come into these situations, we would ask for that. We'd ask that you would wake up Anthony. We'd ask that you would heal John. We pray for the families of this young man that passed away and those that are also recovering. Lord, we just ask for your healing hand there and your comfort in those families' lives. We thank you for the many things that you are doing in people's lives as well as in your church here. And we pray for those in the persecuted church, and we dedicate our time tonight to pray for them as well. And lastly, we just thank you for our brother Spike. We thank you for his love for you and for us, and we pray that you would strengthen him in his health and give him a great resolve and purpose and ministry in his life. We love you, and we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. Thank you. We don't want to skip over those important prayer things, and please do take the time to discipline yourself, to write these things down, and pray for these people throughout the week. As a matter of fact, let me get to preaching before I get to preaching, because this isn't from the sermon. This is extra credit, I guess. But verse 10 of Ezra chapter 7, I'll just read it. You don't have to turn there. But it says, "For Ezra had set his heart to study the law of the Lord and to do it and to teach his statutes and rules in Israel." Now, we're not preaching on that today, but just that phrase, Ezra set his heart. That means that he disciplined himself. He premeditated his energies, in this case, to studying the Word of God. And that had major implications in the life of the Israelites as well as in our lives. But for us and our purpose as part of this church family, I just challenge us, set your heart to be in prayer for these families, because it's a heavy season. And by the way, didn't even mention one of the other most important things that I meant to mention, and that is for the families in our church body who are facing the loss of their job because of vaccine mandates. It's a very real thing. And I had someone share that said this is dividing their family. And I think all of us we went through this with the masks, and now we're seeing it with this mandate. But with the January 4th date looming, major implications for our world and very locally for our particular body. So be in prayer for those in our body. And we'll continue to do that, praying as that date draws near. But in any case, I don't want to get too far off, but set your hearts in prayer for one another. Okay, so today, it's a celebration day, even though we're covering a lot of stuff. It may feel like you're drinking from the fire hose, and I just want to say I really am tied up in knots about today, and it actually goes back to 6 years ago before I started here at the church, and the church leaders were interviewing me, and one of the things they said was, we're going to, Lord willing, go into a building program. And at that time, I said, I want zero to do with the building program. I want nothing to do with it. And they said, well, okay, we're probably a ways out anyway, and we just kind of brushed by it. And well, guess what? Here we are. We're in a building program. And not only is it a great thing, I think it is God's direction for our church. And what we're seeing in this process of erecting a facility is his church growing. And we have the physical needs of a new facility, But greater than the physical needs of the new facility is the discipleship that's going to take place and the outreach that's going to take place. And this new facility will aid in that. It's not the be-all, end-all, but it'll play a big part. And today, we're taking an opportunity to both celebrate that and to look forward with what's next. Because 2 years ago, almost this Sunday, we started our building campaign. And if you're here as a visitor, and we have many of them this morning, I am sorry. You're probably thinking, all churches ever do is talk about money. Yeah, I know. I hear that. That is not true of us, just so that you know. It's not true of this body of believers. We spent a full month speaking about stewardship 2 years ago, teaching on the topic of money because it's very central to people's discipleship. But we haven't talked about it probably enough since that two-year point. We don't, and we do it intentionally, we don't focus too much on money. But if you say that money doesn't have a major part of your relationship with the Lord, then you're lying to yourself, and you're discounting part of God's word. So even with that being said, I know that it can be a sensitive issue. But we get to kind of celebrate this, because 2 years ago, now actually it goes back further than that, when this church was planted in 1961 for the purpose of loving this town with the love of Christ, there was a process where this church had to go through. They met in stores and in the post office and some different places. Eventually, they built that chapel that's right over there, and then added on three more subsequent times to this space. And then about 20 years ago, the church family took the step to buy first 8 and then an adjoining 4. So 12 acres adjoined across from the ball fields. And the purpose of that was to one day be able to build a new church facility. And so that's kind of been in a dormancy process for some time. And now here we are in this process. If we were to speed up to about 4 years ago, you as a church felt, because of a lot of the reasons why we were having space issues, but also feeling like we don't want to invest money into this building while we have paid for property over there. So we decided to start the process of building a new church facility. So all of you that were here at that time, remember this, you filled out a survey, and it was kind of a fun experience because everybody got to write down, like, how, if we were to build our dream church that would be a resource for Yacolt, what would that church look like? What would it have in it? And then you all gave all of your input. And the building team took all of that input and kind of galvanized it together, distilled it down to the main elements. And those main elements were then instilled into and given to an architect. And then that architect gave us the plans. And now those plans you can see out in the foyer in a 3D model. That came from you. Well, then there was the process of, okay, what are some of the next steps? And then that came to the next large milestone, which was 2 years ago this week. And that was, how are we going to pay for this? Because 2 years ago at this time, we had in our building fund about $35,000. A church costs a little bit more than that to build. And so we set a goal of $1 million to raise. And so with that $1 million, we asked the congregation, would you be willing to make a 3-year commitment of giving, either in big chunks or once a month, over a 3-year period towards this $1 million goal. And over that time, we received commitments, hard commitments, almost totaling $800,000 in cash money, and then an additional $200,000 in what we call gifts in kind, which is, hey, I'm a plumber. Hey, I'm good with my hands. Hey, I can drive a machine. I'll donate my time. And so an additional $200,000. And so after that original campaign 2 years ago, we had that commitment of just over $1 million. Andy will share the details in just a moment. But very encouraging. And now what's even more encouraging, what's worthy of celebration, is that we're only 2 years into that 3-year process. And in this first 2 years, we're already 75% complete for that full 3 years. So we were way ahead of schedule. And not only that, not only have you as a church been giving towards this graciously and generously, our church budget as well has been given additional money. There's been additional money going in, which is a blessing, not a ton, but it's more than willing to support our missionaries and keep the lights on and support our staff and those kinds of things, as well as grow our staff. So much great stuff over these last 2 years. And by the way, this was while a lot of churches were shutting their doors. Well, a lot of churches are going through really difficult times, in part due to COVID, in part due to a lot of those things, and in part due to just rough waters for people. And yet, here you are as what you've been giving into sacrificially over this last 2 years. So there's a lot to celebrate. There's a bunch of other things I could talk about here, but I don't know if I will. Yeah, there's good stuff. All right, I'll tell you what. Let's do this. We have had a really great participation from the church body, even though within this. And we call our building campaign MBF, which is Moving by Faith. You have the building project, but then you have the how you're going to pay for it, which is MBF or Moving by Faith. And we've had in our body 50% of our people have participated in this process of raising that $1 million. That's awesome. It also means there's 50% of us that haven't. And that might be for a number of different reasons. If you're not a regular here, this isn't your church, or you don't feel like this is what you want to be participating in, no one's going to twist your arm. No one even knows that information. There's only two people in our entire church that know that, and they're the financial secretaries who count and put that money in. It's really between you and the Lord. And so just it's exciting that there's so much participation up until this point. And part of seeing that participation is going to be in this video that we're about to play. So we'll go ahead and roll this video, and it'll give a little bit of where we've been and where we're going.
Jesus, there's nothing impossible for you. When all I see are the exits, you see the beauty. Thank you, God. When all I see is the cross, God, you see the edge. You say, so wait, I fight, I'll fight on my knees. can stand against the power of our God. In almighty fortress, you're going to be for.
When I think about the building project, I think phenomenal.
The word that I would use to describe my feeling about the church building project is community.
One word would be faith.
Vision, sacrifice, and worship.
I would say faithful because God is faithful.
I would say joyful.
Exciting.
My one word answer is peace.
The one word would be blessed.
Awesome. It's awesome to see all the church members coming together to get things done.
I'm supporting and participating in the project because I feel the desire strongly to be with everybody. I'm really hoping that in one church I can be with all my friends and not separate services.
I support and participate in this project because I think it's important to our town to have a community church that everyone can attend.
I support and participate in the project because that's what the Lord told me to do.
I feel like God is leading me to do it.
I think Jesus wants to see more people saved.
Mm-hmm. I want to see all of us together in one big church.
Well, years ago when I first started discussing building a church there on the property, I had visions of running Dozer. And as it happened, Bill Doty brought his dozer over on groundbreaking day, and Bill was the official groundbreaker for about 15 minutes, and then he graciously turned it over to me and hammered down.
I'm involved in this project because of the lure of the unknown placed in us by God.
I support and participate in the project for the same reason, that I feel very blessed to be with the people that I'm around, the people that I'm with, and to see our church growing to where we can serve this community.
It takes a tribe to build a village.
Awesome. Awesome. All right, Ezra 7. Again, this is the shortest sermon you'll ever hear from me. Ezra 7, and we're just going to draw a couple quick principles out. We'll give the full treatment of Ezra chapter 7 in a couple weeks, but this is just kind of in light of where we're at today. There's some pretty cool stuff here. I'm gonna read. You can follow along if you'd like, and just don't laugh at my pronunciation of some of these names. All right, verse 1, it says, "Now after this," that's important, we'll come back to that. "Now after this, in the reign of Artaxerxes, king of Persia, Ezra, the son of Seraiah, son of Azariah, son of Hilkiah, son of Shalom, son of Zadok, son of Atab, son of Amariah, son of Azariah, son of Meroth, son of Zariah, son of Uzi, son of Buki, son of Abishu, son of Phinehas, son of Eleazar, son of Aaron, the chief priest. This Ezra went up from Babylon. He was a scribe skilled in the law of Moses, and the Lord, the God of Israel, had given, and the king granted him all that he'd asked for the hand of the Lord his God was upon him." Verse 7, "And there went up also to Jerusalem the seventh year of Artaxerxes the king, some of the people of Israel." All right, we'll stop there. There's a few important things. You might say, why in the world would you read that list of names? Well, one, it's in God's word, but it just points out, for example, something that's very important in Hebrew tradition is to make sure that you are part of the lineage. And so even though we today might not understand all those names, the nation Israel, this is how they verified the text and what was what was verifiable is once those names were all in order, they could go back and look in the records and verify what was written. So it's very important historically, but that's kind of beside the point. Where we're at here in Ezra, you have, hopefully, if you got one of your black and white little deals here, on the back is a little timeline. You'll want to kind of keep that timeline with you the rest of this series, both in Ezra and Nehemiah. But something to make note of right now is if you look at that upper left-hand corner, which was in beautiful green, now it's in gray, it says Ezra 1 through 6. See that? Does everybody see that? Okay. Yes? Yes, okay, a few of you. All right, now if you look all the way over, almost all the way to the right, right before Nehemiah, it says Ezra 7 through 10. Right? See that? Okay. So when we say here in verse 1 of chapter 7, it says, now after this, we got to recognize something. That is 58 years between the end of verse 22 and that first verse, now after this. Now after this, after these 58 years, and then he goes into this this genealogy and then speaks of, for the first time in all of our, we've been in Ezra 8 weeks, it's the first time we get to hear anything about the man who's named after the book, Ezra. And so we're going to get into Ezra more another day. But just a picture of what's going on there. Now, if for those of you who are here, if you think back to verse 1 or chapter 1, our first week in this series in Ezra, we noted that the people of God in this entire book of Ezra is about the return of the exiles. The Israelite people have been captured and they're held in Babylon. But then this pagan king conquers Babylonia and releases the Israelites to go and to rebuild this temple. That's what you're seeing in chapters 1 through 6, that rebuilding. It took about 20 years from verse 1 of chapter 1 to verse 22 of chapter 6. We talked about everything that kind of went into that. But now when Ezra comes on the scene 58 years later, something very important is happening. The Lord is using Ezra to bring a second wave of Israelites from Babylonia to Israel, or to the promised land, to fulfill prophecy as well as to live out their faith as God designed it. And there's actually going to be a third wave of exiles, and that's going to come in the book of Nehemiah. Wave number one was rebuilding the temple. This second wave that Ezra is going to be leading is rebuilding the theological roots and the culture of the Israelite people. And then the third wave is going to be the rebuilding of the walls around the city. Now, where does all that, why is that important? Well, we'll dig into all of that down the road. Where it's at for us today and what's applicable for us today, and I know that this is it's a leap. I'm drawing a principle. The text isn't saying this as an application, but it's an applicable. Add that to my dictionary of made-up words. It's applicable for us today in the sense that we've just talked about, you know, the last 2 years of our program and the engagement from this church body and just seeing what the Lord has done through all your energies and efforts. 100+ of you who have been helping hands-on in the project from the raising of the tent all the way up to where we're at today. And that was a good, solid push. But now that we're nearing, we have this last year of our building campaign, we're ready for the second push, and it's going to take a second wave of energy from this church body to carry us on to that next phase. And again, if you're visiting here, if this isn't your church, this call isn't for you. But if this is your church home, you need to be asking the Lord, in what ways can I engage both financially, in my time, in my energies, moving to this next phase, this next push. And then we'll have another push, just like Nehemiah had a push to build a wall. I don't think we're building a big wall around the church, are we? We're not going to be doing that, but we'll have processes. And so we're going to show this one more recap video, then Andy's going to come up and give a little bit of an update. Or do you want to do that update first? I can't remember. Let me look at my list. I did it right in first service. Actually, it's you first. There you go. This is Andy. Everybody give it up for Andy.
Thanks, Phil. Thank you, Bill. You know, we're always under time pressure, but I'm going to steal 2 or 3 minutes that I didn't do in the first service, because when I look out here, half of you were not here 2 or 3 years ago. So you're not aware of what went into the preparation for something like a stewardship campaign. But we spent 4 to 5 months enlisting about 25 or 30 people to serve on leadership teams. And we trained them. My background was in campaigns. We trained those people how to do a campaign that was focused on four things. Those four things were information, involvement, prayer, and stewardship. We have used visual materials, we've had small gatherings, we've had printed materials and pulpit messages to give you the best information as to why we're doing this. It's not a monument for any one person. We have also had many people join the teams to where now we have most people in the church doing something. We had a prayer captain who led us in prayer. You have probably been using the prayer calendar that Barb developed for the last 2 years. For every month, we have prayer requests for every day. Now, how many churches do that? Not many that I know of. And finally, we put a great emphasis on stewardship, not just about money, but as a way of life. How do you manage everything God has given to you? So those were the foundational points of our campaign. Bill mentioned that obviously money is a part of it. You might design a great house and have a huge list of materials, but until you have the financial resources, you can't build the house. I want a page to be put on the screen that gives you an idea of where we are income-wise. This should be, at the end of next year, that should be a 22 instead of a 21. But we had initial building funds, and then we did our moving by faith, and those numbers are indicated there. We received a foundation grant. Bill said we mentioned moved $150,000 from the general fund to the moving by faith fund. And as of the end of October, we had $1,200,471 actually committed to this campaign. We haven't received all of the grant yet, but that's guaranteed. There should be another $165,000 that comes in the next year to complete Moving by Faith based on two things: the pledges or the commitments that people made, and then those who have jumped on since then and have been giving money even though they never filled out a commitment card. The bottom line is the giving spirit of people. So the value of this campaign ultimately is $1,365,471. I've worked in about 300 campaigns. That's an outstanding figure for a 3-year campaign with a church our size. And you've heard already today that credit belongs to God. I want to show you what we're looking at in terms of how we spend our money, because what comes in must go out. So there's another slide on what we've done so far. We have broken this effort of building a new church into stages: stage one, stage two, stage three. We're seeking to complete the first 3 stages by the end of this year. Now, we hope that's possible. We pray that's possible. But these are the expenses: engineering, permitting, the steel package, the building, $700,000. Land development, $350,000. Foundation and underpad, $172,000. So we anticipate spending $1,225,000. And we don't have all of that in yet. But we're very close to being even. We're not spending money we don't have. This does not count donated labor, machinery, materials, and believe me, that's probably in the range of $200,000 plus. So when you look at those 2 sheets, you get a picture of the money part of the campaign. And I'll come back and share with you what we're going to do 2 weeks from today.
Great. All right, so just a few quick words before we show another video. First off, where are we at now with the project itself? So our groundwork is about 25% of the way done, which is huge. And these are, I got these this morning, were handed to me. We just got these are the approved civil engineering plans, which means the town signed off, fire department signed off, all of the important powers that be have signed off on our plans so we can continue on and finish up all of our grading. So it's huge, huge praise and to get that in hand this morning. We're not gonna be doing a whole lot of dirt work over the winter because of the weather, but there's other projects and things that we can be doing in the meantime. One thing you need to know in that figure that was shown up there is we've already purchased the entire shell, the structure, the materials, which is about, it kept going up, that's why we bought it, about $600,000, $550,000, which is the entire shell, including the roof and the sides and those kind of things. That's going to be delivered at the end of the year. And what we hope to do we would love to get it done before the end of the year. It's probably not going to happen, but we need to get the foundation in place so that we can begin erecting that building. And we hope certainly to have that portion done by early spring or get that foundation laid and start erecting the building. So that way when fall comes, we'll be working inside of it, doing the finishing touches. But of course, all of that depends on the process of what the Lord brings in. We have this church building, which we own outright, up for sale. It's up for sale for $1.1 million. And we have a buyer that's interested, but they're dragging their feet a little bit, and so we'll see where that goes. There's a lot of other components that we have, but right now we're kind of moving at the right pace with the funds that we have, and we need to continue to raise funds. So this video that we're showing now, just so you know, this kind of gives a picture of how the process has been going, as well as how we see it continuing. I'm just going to play the video and let it speak for itself. So go ahead.
Hello, my name is Chris Waters. I just want to show you what we got going out here today at the church property. It's called the Dig It class. It's for Wednesday Connect. But anyway, so we basically what we got going on are kids out here working with equipment, learning how to run everything. So we got a couple kids over here on the tractor. Behind me here, we got one kid on the excavator right here, another one on the roller, and you can't really see him, but up on the hill, we have a few kids sitting on dozers. So it's kind of fun stuff, but there's a lot of opportunities out here. So if these kids are willing to come out here and learn how to run this equipment, so can you. Don't be afraid of it. It might be big stuff, but it's all stuff we can do. And there's Hunter. I'm running that. Anyways, I'll show you the kids on the dozer over here behind me. But anyways, real exciting stuff. You know, it's a good learning for all the kids, and we're also building the church. All right, thanks.
There are a lot of men and women who have taken leadership in this effort, and Chris is one of them. And this would never happen without all of the people who go to that property every day and do something. If you want more detail, there's the old parsonage, and there are charts and maps, and I learned even snacks over there. So you can stop by and get all the information you want. You can talk to one of the elders, one of the building committee. We want you to have the best information. Now, what I'd like to go over with you now is a commitment sheet that we will bring to church in 2 weeks. We will invite every family. Invite, it's not a command performance. We're going to invite you to participate with what God has entrusted to you. Every one of us has a basket of resources, and it's all different. But the challenge is, what is God asking me to do and you to do if this indeed is your home church? Because we're not going to get it financed by the Baptist Church in Battleground. It'll be financed by Yacolt Community Church and how God leads us to do that. Now, 2 years ago, we asked you that were here to complete a commitment card about what God was telling you to do. and those were collected. And that's the money that Bill talked about. 50 cards came in, and we're asking you, when you get this, if you did that, to make a check, simply to let us know that you were on board. And if the second line is true, where I made a commitment and expect to complete it by the end of October 22, we want you to check that line. The third line, in addition to the commitment that we made in October of 19, we believe God is leading us to give an additional amount of money. We find, and I never see the books because only two people see those, but they're finding that there are a fair number of you who've already completed your commitment. There are some who are still giving beyond that commitment. That's why the money is coming in so well. And so we're asking you, if you're done, you're completed, are you willing to step out one more time for the next 12 months and give to Moving by Faith? That's entirely your choice. But I know it's going to take that kind of involvement to get us to that point. If you weren't here, we're inviting you to make a 12-month commitment over the next year as to what you can do with the resources God has given to you. And that takes you to line four. Dr. Bob, who is in the first service, met with an attorney to find out how we can use short-term, low-interest promissory notes. I've worked with churches that have done this. And that will only come if we don't have enough money to take us through the next phase. And I was talking with Bill earlier, and he will mention to you what it's going to take to get to that point where we have all our bills paid and we're ready to do the work on the inside of the church. We didn't hand this out today because we're asking you to look at it, to go home and pray, Lord, what do you want to do through me for the good of our church and for the good of this community? And then when you've done that, you can sign it and we'll collect them next week. Thank you.
All right, thank you, Andy. Okay, so just a few things and then we'll wrap up here. One of the ways that we're gonna go about this process is we have a business meeting that is coming up on the 21st, so 2 weeks from today. And you'll get an email if you're a member at the church, you'll get an email this afternoon. The things that we're gonna be looking at that is, we have in our church budget, we set aside $150,000 as an emergency fund. And a while back, that emergency fund was beyond $300,000. And so we asked the congregation if we could move the additional above the 150 into our building campaign. And the church said yes. And so we took that and put that towards the project. Well, now as the Lord blesses, there's new funds that kind of come in that are beyond our budget, that are beyond the actual giving. And we're going to ask the members, the congregation, if we can continue to, on a monthly basis, take any excess above that 150 and put it towards the building fund. That's something we want the buy-in from the congregation. So that's one thing on that list. The other one is this promissory note mentioned that we've talked to lawyers, we are committed to not borrowing outside of the church. And so if there's those that have funds available, we want to ask the church if that is okay. So we don't just make these decisions arbitrarily in a closed door meeting. When they're big decisions like this, we like to bring that to the congregation. And so between now and then, if you have any questions at all about anything that was said today, because this is like drinking from a fire hose, nothing is hidden. You can, Andy made the, he didn't mean to say it like this. He said, no one sees the books but two people. No one sees who gives but two people. No one knows the record of who gives except those two financial secretaries. But the books are open 100% to anyone and everybody. So if you have any questions about any of these numbers or any, what are we doing this way or that way, then please let any of us know. You can contact the office or send an email. We are more than excited and happy to answer any questions whatsoever because we can't answer them all here at this time. But in any case, thank you for putting up with, I don't want to say putting up. I really do believe this is good for us, but I know that this is not the norm for us. And a special thank you to those of you who have really put some leadership in and some dedication. And I'm fearful of mentioning too many people's names. Andy mentioned Chris earlier. Really thankful to Doug as well. Doug, for your presence continually at the property and helping out with the kids dig it process. You know, huge encouragement. Brian Walker, Dennis Fox, Alan Hunter, Tamara O'Brien, who's doing a lot of the administration, some people that are really putting in above and beyond efforts and time. And so thank you all for that, and please do take the next few weeks to ask the Lord what your part of this is. And again, there's no arm twisting here. There's no arm twisting whatsoever. So, okay, I would like to invite you to stand and ask the worship team to come forward and lead us in an awesome closing
guys for coming this morning. That concludes our service. We'll see you guys next Sunday. Have a great week.